Hello, my name's David White and I'm from Technology Assisted Lifelong Learning, which is a unit in the Continuing Education Department here at the University of Oxford. And myself and my colleague Marion Manton, who will appear later on, are going to just give a short talk about a project, just funded project, called OER Impact that we did at the first half of this year. And that project was looking at the reuse of open educational resources, not the production of them, but the reuse of them. The project produced a couple of reports which you can get to by following this link. One of the reports is a full research report, so if you want to really get roll your sleeves up and get stuck in with our data, then you can look at that one. There's another report which we're sort of calling an accessible report, which is shorter and it contains our recommendations. And this presentation is sort of cherry-picking from that report to give you an idea of what we found and what we're recommending. Now, the study itself took a very qualitative approach, and we interviewed and ran workshops with a range of people in different roles within higher education institutions. So we talked to people that we're calling strategists. Their responsibility was to embed and develop technology-enhanced learning strategies within their institutions. We also spoke to tutors. So these are tutors who are directly teaching on programmes of study or on courses. They're in front of students face-to-face. And we also spoke to the students themselves. And the reports and this presentation are drawn from the data we found from those interviews and those workshops. Okay, so the first thing to say, just to give you a little bit of background, is that open educational resources are just a massive swathe of types of things, if you like, and they come in all different sizes. So, for example, that one end of the spectrum, there might be a full module that would be in something like the Open University's OpenLearn platform, all the way through to perhaps a single image that somebody would pick up from maybe a service like Flickr and place into a lecture or into a PowerPoint. So it's a vast area in that sense. Open educational resources, a strict definition of them, tends to include the idea of an open license being attached to them, like Creative Commons, for example, and that allows people to legally take resources, duplicate them, put them in their own spaces online, potentially edit or repurpose them. And for some of the people that we spoke to, this was very important. They tended to be the people who were reusing in a visible way in the name of the institution. So it was something that had the institution's reputation attached to it. So an example of that would be somebody who was perhaps producing an online module that they were going to use with students or that they were going to re-release out onto the web. And they'd construct that by reusing smaller pieces of OER and constructing them into a larger structure. And that's where the licensing became very important because it was attached to institutional reputation. Now, having said that, the majority of people that we spoke to, in this case, mainly the academic staff, saw open educational resources in a much more flexible way. And to them, it was the educational aspects of the resources, not surprisingly, which were more important to them. So how relevant they were to their program of study, whether they solved a particular teaching problem. They weren't necessarily considering licensing. They were very respectful of the idea of citing where the resource came from, but they weren't necessarily looking at it in a strict legal sense. So that led us to produce this iceberg metaphor, in which the tip of the iceberg is where that kind of visible reuse is taking place, and Creative Commons or open licenses of those form become very important. But the vast majority of reuse is taking place below the waterline, if you like, within programmes of study, within courses, which are relatively private spaces. So, for example, resources that have been placed in virtual learning environments for specific modules or perhaps using images in PowerPoints. This seems to be fairly standard practice. And below that waterline, where it's less visible, if you like, the importance of licensing is not something that people were really considering. It's a relatively kind of low-risk scenario. One of the key messages that came out of the study that came from tutors, but especially from students, was the value of collating lists or embedding resources into spaces like virtual learning environments. Now, students recognised, especially early stage students, that they couldn't necessarily critically evaluate the search return from something like Google. They didn't know whether they were going to be wasting their time looking at maybe irrelevant or inaccurate sources. And so they wanted to go somewhere trusted. They wanted to go somewhere where there were just a simple list of resources that tutors had put together that they knew were valid and relevant. And although that isn't particularly pedagogically glamorous, it was the case that students kind of expected this and really appreciated it and took advantage of it. Yes. So that's one specific example of reuse, but obviously there are different forms of reuse in different contexts. It's, as I say, a large space. So that led us to create this sort of map of the reuse landscape. Now, out of our data, quite a lot of the activity was in that independent quadrant, but most of it was where the independent quadrant blurs into the strategic or the appropriated. Okay, so this is what I was just talking about in terms of gathering together resources in virtual learning environments. We did also find activity in that ratified quadrant, which would be in the tip of the iceberg. There was less of that, proportionally speaking, and it could be the case that that's because that kind of activity is done by more specific kind of production teams rather than necessarily those people who are, you know, at the coalface of day-to-day teaching. So that gives you an idea of the space that our study was working in terms of the reuse of open educational resources and digital resources more generally. I'm now going to hand over to Marion Manton, who's going to talk about the academic practice of reuse on a day-to-day basis.
Thanks, Dave. So talking about how people are actually using digital resources, the first thing to say is that they really are doing this. This is common practice. People are out there engaging in it, and it's not hard to convince people that it's going to add value to what they do. In terms of thinking about this value, most academics see this in terms of improving the quality of what they do, adding richness to their teaching and learning, providing students with new or different learning opportunities they would not have otherwise had. What they don't see it as is a way to save time. And I think they're probably right in this, in that it does take time to find good online resources. In the longer term, there probably will be time savings as you can reuse a digital resource every time you run a course. But in the short term, that isn't how they're thinking about the benefits that it offers them. Given that using digital resources is fairly standard practice, there are still some barriers to the uptake of digital resources and OER. And the main one really is how you discover things. This does vary across disciplines, but it's still, as I alluded to earlier, can be quite hard to find good teaching and learning resources online. What has changed is that moving on from a few years ago where people were very sceptical about what might be out there for them in terms of their teaching and learning on the web, people do tend to believe that there are resources out there, but they can't necessarily find them. Unsurprisingly, the place where most people start looking for digital resources is Google. But sometimes this can throw up far too many results, and there are definitely certain disciplines where being able to go to repositories, trusted sites, .edu, .ac.uk, NGOs, big institutions like the BBC, where you can assume that there's some sort of quality control over the material, becomes really important. A good example of this was a lecturer we talked to in nutrition, where there's lots of misinformation available on the web, and you don't want your students to be stumbling across that and thinking that that's fact. Starting in sites that already had some sort of quality control meant that instead of having to go through several hundred links to find one good one, she could get to the really useful information much more quickly. With this in mind, there is a role for repositories, but they have to be searchable by Google. Otherwise, you're going to miss a huge swathe of your audience, a lot of your lecturers, but most importantly, virtually all of your students. About how lecturers take the resources that they find and use it in their teaching and learning, it's really not that different from how they've used the resources they've supported their teaching and learning with in the past. Like journals, like textbooks, like lectures, sometimes it's part of the core teaching, sometimes it's something that you direct students to research a topic, sometimes it's part of supplementary materials. All these kind of practices were found in our research, and none of them were massively dominant over any other. There were a couple of interesting themes, though, that it's worth pointing out. In terms of sheer volume of reuse, a lot of what we found was reuse of small things. People taking that little nugget that they can use in a lecture, for a PowerPoint, whether it's a diagram, whether it's a particular piece of multimedia that illustrates a key point. Those were the kinds of things where people went looking for a resource because they had a particular problem in mind. They found it, they took it, they used it. That's a very common form of reuse. Connected to this was reuse of things in media that people were not able to produce themselves. I need a diagram to illustrate this point. I want a video to show this concept. I want a piece of multimedia that will make this difficult to understand concept much clearer. But I don't have the skills to make that. That's when people go to the web to find stuff. And that's something that the sorts of media that are available on the web has really transformed people's approach to. I can give my students something I could never give them in the past because there are these great free resources out there that I can give them access to. As well as more concrete reuse, a lot of reuse happens on the more conceptual plane. This is people looking at other people's work and using it as a source of ideas for inspiration or for benchmarking. Looking at how someone's taught a particular activity and saying, right, I'm going to teach it in a similar way to address because I have a similar problem. Or perhaps going to OER produced by very prominent universities who are teaching a very similar course to you and having a look at what they're doing, benchmarking your practice against what they're doing and using that to inform how you can make your own course better. Obviously, neither of these forms of use leave much of a track, but I think they have a lot of significance in terms of where people are getting value from OER. I'm now going to hand over to Dave White, who's going to discuss some of the recommendations that came out of the study.
Thank you, Marion. The first recommendation that is useful to go through is harking back to something that we said towards the start of the presentation, this idea of collating digital resources, usually in a virtual learning environment, and the value of that. Okay, so if you like, this is a kind of digital reading list, which also includes media such as potentially as video, multimedia, podcasts as well. And although this is not pedagogically very radical, we know that students find it very, very useful. So the next recommendation is an emerging area that's being driven by open educational resources and digital resources more generally. And it's to do with these resources that you could say were beyond text, so the videos, the podcasts, etc. Now we know that students find these very useful in their learning, but they're less certain, they're actually quite nervous about whether they can incorporate them or how they can incorporate them into assessed work. They don't know about the legitimacy of that, they're worried about potential plagiarism, and they don't necessarily know the formal processes of citing sort of non-text-based resources. And I think that this is something that they could be advised on in terms of digital or learning literacies, if you like, and be given advice on where the boundaries are in terms of what you can cite, what might be better not to cite, and how to perhaps blend these different resources together in assessed work. So the final recommendation I want to go through in this presentation is to do with the way that the reuse of OER and digital resources might be rolled out or embedded within your institution. And I think it's fair to say that this area should be treated as a subset of existing strategies that are tackling enhancing teaching and learning using technology or digital and learning literacy, so those kind of areas. And so OER and digital resources reuse doesn't have to be treated separately, but can be blended into existing strategies. I think it's also important to say that the most successful forms of reuse and where you really start to see the benefit is when you start to move towards open forms of practice. So whether that's open perhaps within a course team, so team teaching, or whether that's open practice in terms of being more visible with your practice out on the web. So for example, a good example of that would be perhaps if you are collating together digital resources, those collations themselves would also be out on the web for people across the sector to use. And I think that's where we'll really start seeing the benefits in terms of reuse. So that's it from myself and Marion. If you want to know more about what we found in terms of reuse, then follow the link and that will take you to our two key reports. There's a research report, which you can find out the details of our data, and there's a shorter, more accessible report, which we've used for the basis of this presentation.